Second phase of the Cold War. In the second phase, tensions eased considerably, but there was no end to the Cold War. In both the countries, there was a leadership change at the highest level. In the US, President Truman's tenure had come to an end in 1953, and in the Soviet Union, Stalin died in 1953. Stalin was succeeded by Nikita Khrushchev, who retreated on many of the policies of Stalin. On the policy front, Khrushchev stood for the policy of relaxation of tension in Europe and admitted Soviet responsibility for some problems there. On the other hand, he openly suppressed anti-Soviet leaders and ideas in Poland and Hungary and denounced as fascist the activities of liberals and Catholics who expressed Polish and Hungarian nationalism. Soviet leaders during this period also commented critically on racial conflicts in the USA, which they said was inevitable consequences of capitalist inequality. For its part, the USA and its client tried to stir up anti-Soviet feelings in the East European countries. The change of leaders in the USSR and Khrushchev's denunciation of Stalinism inspired revolts in Poland and Hungary. In 1956, revolt broke out in Poznan city of Poland and was suppressed also. The Communist Party of Poland became divided into two factions, one Stalinist and the other owing allegiance to Gomulka. Gomulka's faction succeeded and the Communist Party of Poland decided to pursue a national road to socialism. This meant that Poland would have more control over its affairs as long as it respected Soviet hegemony, for instance, in economic and military affairs throughout Eastern Europe. Thus, Poland became the second country after Yugoslavia to follow the path of nationalist communism, which most Soviet leaders accepted within limit. In Hungary, people rose in revolt in 1956. The Soviet Union initially agreed to some reforms, but when Hungarians demanded complete withdrawal of the Soviet troops and Hungary's withdrawal from the Warsaw Pact, which was set up by the Soviet Union in response to NATO, that is NATO, the Soviet leadership got annoyed with the new course. The final declaration of Hungary's neutrality and withdrawal from the Warsaw Pact led to the execution of Imre Nagy, the then ruler of Hungary, and the attack on Hungary by the Soviet Union. Thus, the Soviet Union made it clear that it was not ready to accept a liberalized communist regime or a multi-party democracy in Poland. The United States did not do much about it, as any action on its part would probably have led to the direct confrontation between the Soviet Union and the United States of America. After the Chinese Revolution, General Chiang Kai-shek led his followers across the Taiwan Strait and set up the Republic of China, which continued to represent China in the UN till 1971. The American policy before 1950 was not to interfere in Taiwan. Event of attack by the Communist China, that is, People's Republic of China. But after the Korean War in 1950, the United States policy changed, and after 1953, the United States President Eisenhower agreed to massive American rearmament of Taiwan. In 1954, the PRC, China, declared that Taiwan had to be liberated and accordingly started military operations. The US on its part threatened to use nuclear weapons, and war between PRC and the United States seemed imminent. Communist China showed an inclination to back down, and the NATO states declared that they would not support American use of nuclear weapons. During this period, the Chinese leaders believed that the advances made by the USSR in the development of long-range delivery systems for nuclear weapons had tilted the European balance of power in favor of the Eastern Bloc. Chinese leaders were not sure what USSR military resurgence would mean for them. Perhaps it would make the USA less likely to threaten China. When the Chinese bombarded Quemoy in 1957, it was the USSR that pressured the People's Republic of China to stop. Ultimately, direct Sino-USA war was avoided. But Chinese communist suspicion of the USA and the USSR increased. The Suez Canal was constructed in the mid-19th century by the British and the French. The Suez Canal Company enjoyed the right to operate the canal and earn profits for a period of 99 years, commencing from 1869. The Egyptian decision to nationalize the Suez Canal that is, make it a part of Egyptian national territory in 1956, led to a series of crises. Britain, France, and Israel decided to initiate a concerted military campaign against Egypt. America was against the use of force, but Israel attacked Egypt in collusion with Britain and France. This forced the USA to condemn its own allies, and for the first time since the Cold War, the USA and the Soviet Union came together on this issue. Britain and France had to accept a UN peacekeeping force for the canal. The imperial decline of France, which had tried to remain independent of the USA security bloc, speeded up after the Suez Crisis. Britain too was now generally recognized as being only a second-rate power and junior partner of the United States. In Cuba, Fidel Castro came to power after many years of struggle in 1959. He brought Cuba closer to the Soviet Union within a few years. The USA cut off diplomatic relations with Cuba, refused to purchase Cuban sugar, and supported an invasion of Cuba in 1961 by anti-Castro Cubans who were living in exile in the USA. The exiles attempted a landing at the Bay of Pigs. The invasion turned out to be a complete failure, as the exiles got no support from the people of Cuba. The Soviet Union then decided to install a nuclear bomber and ground-to-ground missiles in Cuba, some of them only 150 kilometers from the United States. The Soviet Union also dispatched dozens of long-range missiles to Cuba. Since 1949, the USA had put bomber and missile bases in Norway, Turkey, and other places directly adjacent to the USSR. The USA in turn announced a blockade of Cuba. There was a strong possibility of war between the superpowers. Initially, the Soviet Union denounced the blockade, but later agreed to withdraw the missiles on the condition that the Americans would not invade Cuba and would remove their medium-range nuclear missiles from Turkey. The USA agreed to the first condition. They soon removed missiles from Turkey with the excuse that they were outdated. This was probably the closest the superpowers could come to nuclear war during the Cold War. The Soviet Union virtually gave an ultimatum to the Western powers, demanding demilitarization of all of Berlin within 6 months. The USSR would remove its occupation troops if the other occupiers did the same. If agreement was not reached within 6 months, the Soviet Union was to transfer its occupation rights in East Berlin to the German Democratic Republic. When Soviet troops surrounded the city, the West Berliners and foreign occupiers were supplied by an air bridge eventually. Some Soviet leaders decided they could not easily force the Western powers out of Berlin, the city they had lost so many troops in occupying at the end of the Second World War. The Berlin crisis was not so much diffused as one in favor of the Western occupation forces. The Soviet Union continued to be worried during the 1950s by the flight of many workers and professionals from East Germany to West Germany via Berlin. When they resumed pressure against the Western occupiers over the Berlin question, the latter changed some of the terms of occupation to prevent being drawn into a major conflict over Germany. West Germany, the German Federal Republic, was being rearmed after 1955 and given effective control over most of the Western occupation zones, where the communists were outlawed for some time. In 1961, the Soviet occupiers of East Berlin built a concrete wall to prevent East Germans from fleeing to the West German state. The Berlin Wall became a symbol of Cold War politics until Germans tore it down in 1989-90. During the second phase of the Cold War, there was a thaw between the two superpowers, but on certain occasions, as during the Cuban missile crisis in 1962, the possibility of a nuclear war and its catastrophic effects were an important factor that forced the two superpowers to change their attitudes. In both the countries, there was pressure to reduce military expenditure. Some grounds for improved relationship between the two superpowers had already been made. In 1963, the Soviet Union, the USA, and Britain had signed a nuclear test ban treaty and agreed to carry out their nuclear test underground only to avoid polluting the atmosphere any further. In the same year, a telephonic link, the so-called hotline, was introduced between Moscow and Washington to ensure swift consultations. The Soviet Union and the United States relationship now entered a new phase, which has been described as the détente, a term that was used for relaxation in East-West conflict. The détente was also to take into account China. The relationship between the US and China had been tense for past few years. The détente with China was a notable achievement. The Cold War did not end during this period, but there were improved levels of understanding. Henry Kissinger, an American official, described détente as a mode of arrangement of adversary power. Leonid Brezhnev, who succeeded Khrushchev as Soviet leader after the Cuban Missile Crisis, described détente as willingness to resolve differences and disputes not by force, not by threats and saber rattling, but by peaceful means at the conference table. It also means a certain trust and ability to consider each other's legitimate interest. President Nixon of the United States has been described as the author of détente, but this is more appropriate in the context of US-China relations. Although Nixon had based his political career during the 1940s, 60s as an anti-communist hardliner, when elected president in 1968, he took steps to improve United States relations with China. Several steps were taken by both the countries to ease the tension. In 1968, a nuclear non-proliferation treaty was signed by UK, USA and the USSR. A major area of conflict between the two superpowers was the two Germanies and Berlin. In 1969, the government of West Germany initiated the policy of Ostpolitik, which means a policy for the East. West Germany renewed normal relations with East European countries. Both the Germanies recognized each other and were recognized as separate and legitimate states by the superpowers. The two Germanies joined the United Nations in 1973. In 1972, US and the Soviet Union signed the Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty. The agreement did not reduce the amount of armaments, but did slow down the arms race. The then President of the Soviet Union and the USA met thrice, Brezhnev and Nixon respectively. The USA also started exporting wheat to the Soviet Union. In July 1975, 35 countries assembled for the Helsinki Conference. The signing of its final act was regarded for the time being as burying the Cold War. The final act contained 10 principles, most important of which was that all the nations were to accept the European frontier, which had been drawn after the Second World War. Thus, the division of Germany was accepted. The communist countries promised to allow their people human rights, including freedom of speech and freedom to leave the country. During the period of détente, USA-China relations improved considerably. President Nixon and Secretary of State Henry Kissinger made special efforts to ease the tension with China. In 1971, China was admitted to the UN and Taiwan was expelled. In 1978, the USA withdrew the recognition of Nationalist China, and in 1979, the USA gave recognition the People's Republic of China, and ambassadors were exchanged. After the Helsinki Conference, the process of détente lost its momentum. Relations between the US and the Soviet Union became so sore that by 1980, it appeared that Cold War had come back. The new tensions came to be described as the new Cold War. The new Cold War was different from the Cold War in the sense that it was not based on ideological conflict, but on balance of power. In the new Cold War, a new power bloc, namely the People's Republic of China, emerged as a power that could not be defeated or ignored. The intervention of the Soviet Union in Afghanistan in 1979 was a turning point. The new Cold War was marked by the efforts of both the countries to spread their influence mainly outside Europe. Conflicts outside Europe assumed greater significance than ever before. Détente for the Soviet Union meant acceptance of status quo in Europe only. In Indochina, Africa, Afghanistan, etc., both the countries supported opposing groups. The Soviet Union replaced the president of Afghanistan by one favorable to it. Nearly 1 lakh Soviet soldiers were stationed in Afghanistan. America regarded the positioning of Soviet soldiers in Afghanistan as a threat to Iran and moved her warships in the Gulf. Both the countries were deeply involved in developing the new weapons of destruction. The United States President Ronald Reagan approved of the plan to develop a new weapons system, the Strategic Defense Initiative, which was also known as Star Wars. The new Cold War came to an end with the collapse of communism in various East European countries. The pace of collapse was very fast, and ultimately communism collapsed in its birthplace, that is the USSR. The process began in Poland in 1988 when the Solidarity Trade Union organized huge anti-government strikes, forcing the government to allow free elections in which the communists were comprehensively defeated. The same happened in Hungary, in Bulgaria, Romania, and Czechoslovakia. In East Germany, the communist leader Erich Honecker wanted to disperse the demonstrators by force, but was overruled by his colleagues, so that by the end of 1989, the communist government had to resign in East Germany, and the Berlin Wall, the symbol of Cold War, was pulled down in 1989 with much public enthusiasm. The fall of the Berlin Wall was taken to be the end of the Cold War, as its erection had been taken as the start of the Cold War. In 1990, the West German currency was introduced in East Germany, and finally the two Germanies were reunited. The Chancellor of Federal Republic of Germany was chosen as the head of the government of the United Country, which adopted market economy and Western type of democracy. In the Soviet Union also, communism collapsed. Mikhail Gorbachev made efforts to transform and revitalize the country by his policies of glasnost, that is openness, and perestroika, that is restructuring, which meant economic and social reforms. But by the end of 1991, the USSR split into separate republics, and Russia alone was not in a position to command the same influence that the old Soviet Union did. The Cold War came to an end. Many political commentators have argued that with the end of the Cold War, the world problems would disappear, but new problems and new areas of conflict have now emerged. Thank you till then.